was speaking about the sense of wonder, Rachel Carson, and it is part of the reason that she felt so deeply about the effects of nuclear weapons, nuclear testing, and the like. All I will say as I introduce our panel on Rachel Carson and ending the nuclear age is that you may not know, Mark mentioned that Rachel's first big bestseller, 1951, The Sea Around Us, it gave her the ability to purchase a summer home in Maine where she raised Roger, her adopted son, and rambled through the woods with him to develop a sense of wonder. It allowed her to build the house in Silver Spring that Chris alluded to and to leave government service so she could devote herself to writing full time. But she wrote a new introduction to The Sea Around Us. Have any of you read The Sea Around Us? That's pretty good. Have you read the second edition from 1961 with the new introduction that warns about the dangers of nuclear testing and radiation and traces scientifically how the radionuclides are absorbed into the food chain, how they bioaccumulate, how ultimately they make their way to the Arctic? And she talks about their effect on Inuit mothers, we now call Eskimo, we used to call Eskimos. That is, again, taking what is otherwise can be a rather dull and complicated and horrible set of things about radiation and radionuclides and bringing it right down with the latest science at that time and how it was affecting people. And so our panel, Ending the Nuclear Age, includes some wonderful people. Let me introduce them and then I don't know if I will do justice. But if you have your program in front of you, Kristen Iversen is a writer. All of these writers I am just in awe of. I say that quite honestly. I spent a lot of time working on nuclear weapons production facilities. You know that to build atomic and nuclear hydrogen bombs, we had 16 industrial facilities around the country that refined the uranium, that made plutonium up at Hanford, that assembled them in Rocky Flats, that put them all together down in Pantex in Texas, in Oak Ridge. All is huge, more than 160,000 people working in 16 industrial facilities just to give us the bombs that destroyed Hiroshima and Nagasaki. And then as we produce some 60,000 nuclear weapons during our lifetimes, that is what went on in these facilities. It happens that Kristen Iversen grew up at Rocky Flats and has written about that in an incredibly beautiful book called Full Body Burden, Growing Up in the Nuclear Shadow of Rocky Flats. And I will feel free to tout all of the author's books that I mentioned. You know we have them all here, thanks to Politics and Prose, available for sale and signing. And after you listen to these women, you are going to want to buy all their books for all your relatives and read them. But Kristen will be talking about her book, her experiences, and Rocky Flats, and what is still a dangerous legacy from these facilities, because those radionuclides don't go away. Then we're going to hear from Susan Cohen. And Susan is an amazing person who we were not able. Susan, you. She has put together a book called Shore Words. Oh, you're on the next panel. Well, don't pay any attention to Susan Cohen or the guy up front. I'm so sorry. That is totally wrong. You'll be there. I'm sorry. Linda Pentz Gunter is a leading expert on nuclear power, both internationally, here at home. She does all of the media development and communicating about nuclear power for a group called Beyond Nuclear that was founded by Helen Caldicott, who founded Physicians for Social Responsibility and other things. And Linda will be talking about the current issues around nuclear power. In particular, I think you know, because of global climate change, there are those who say, we've got to bring back nukes, we've got to keep the nukes. They don't give off carbon dioxide, they're clean, they're renewable. That's what she'll be talking about. And then John Tierney, who I see over in the corner there, will be talking about one of Rachel's great concerns, nuclear weapons and their proliferation. Remember I mentioned she was interested in Adlai Stevenson and John F. Kennedy because she was concerned about open nuclear testing and nuclear weapons. John Tierney has been a 9-term congressman from Massachusetts, where he served on a number of committees that had oversight over intelligence, over Star Wars, over nuclear weapons. And when the House Armed Services Committee wouldn't look into things and properly do their oversight, it was John who held those hearings and helped us on the outside have the information and the platform and the ability to speak further and gather people about that. So those folks will be coming on up, and if you'll join me up front, we'll move to our panel on Rachel Carson and ending the nuclear age. And you can tell your friends that you're now anti-nuclear. Oh, I thought you were an environmentalist. Let's see here. Let's make sure we have room for y'all. Come in, come in, come in. Wherever, let's see, how do they arrange these?
They're arranging them as you speak.
You want to be closer and I'll sit down.
Yeah,
so let us welcome and celebrate our panelists about the nuclear age. And first, we have Kristen Iversen.
Good morning. Thanks so much for being here, and thanks very much to Bob Musil and the Rachel Carson Council for having me here today. I'm really delighted to be here for all sorts of reasons. And one reason is that we just finished a very important community meeting and press conference last week in Colorado related to Rocky Flats. So I'm really happy to be able to be here today and share with you some of the things that happened at this particular event last week, and we did get quite a bit of press, national press, for that, so I'm very excited about that. But first I want to tell you a little bit about my book, Full Body Burden, Growing Up in the Nuclear Shadow of Rocky Flats. I grew up in a very beautiful part of Colorado. If you've been to Boulder, as I'm sure many of you have, you know how beautiful it is there with the foothills right there. And the little community where I grew up, Arvada, is about 9 miles from Boulder and about 11 miles from Denver. It's also, my house, my childhood home, was about 2.5 miles from the Rocky Flats nuclear weapons production plant. I'm gonna grab this because I have a little bit of allergy today from the weather, I think. But we didn't know that when I was a kid. When I was a kid, I grew up in a family, there were four of us kids. My parents thought that they were raising their kids in the perfect environment. We were outside all the time. We had horses and dogs. We went swimming in Stanley Lake, which we discovered later has plutonium in the sediment. We went inner tubing and swimming in the canals that came off the Rocky Flats site. We were outside all the time. What we did not know was that there was extensive radioactive and toxic contamination in the air, in the water, and in the soil. When I was a kid, Dow Chemical operated the plant. Many of the families that I grew up with, their parents worked at the plant. The rumor in our neighborhood, and this is largely because workers were not allowed to talk about what they did, at Rocky Flats, and also we were lied to continuously again and again in the press about what was happening at Rocky Flats. We didn't know. The rumor in our neighborhood was that they were making household cleaning supplies. My mother thought for years that they were making scrubbing bubbles. They were not making scrubbing bubbles at Rocky Flats. They were making plutonium buttons and triggers for nuclear weapons. Over the course of about 38 years at Rocky Flats, we produced more than 70,000 plutonium pits or triggers for nuclear weapons, each one about the size of a grapefruit, slightly flattened half grapefruit, around six and a half pounds or so. Each one of those 70,000 pits was contained enough breathable particles of plutonium to kill every person on Earth. We had no idea. Over the course of that roughly 40 years, there were more than 200 fires at Rocky Flats. There were two big ones, one in 1957, just before I was born, and then another one on Mother's Day, May 11th, 1969. Those two big fires were so extensive that they burned through the filters that was supposed to protect us from any contamination coming from the plant, and also burned out the measuring equipment. So even to the present day, we will never know exactly how much contamination spread over my town of Arvada and the Metro Denver area. Later, when I was getting my, when I was a graduate student at the University of Denver and a single parent with two little kids, looking for a part-time job, I was very interested to hear about how Rachel Carson was kind of pulling it all together. I was kind of doing the same. I worked at Rocky Flats myself. I worked as a level three administrative assistant, and my job there was to work with various managers around the plant to compile information in reports that were ironically called hot lists that were, and I didn't fully understand the irony at the time, but they were sent on to Washington, D.C., and Albuquerque, New Mexico, and other places. So it was a crash course in what was happening at Rocky Flats. I want to tell you very briefly about the day that I decided to quit my job. I came home from work, picked up my kids, put them to bed, came downstairs to fix myself a cup of tea, turned on the television, and there was a Nightline expose on Rocky Flats. They were interviewing people that I worked with, including Mark Silverman, the Department of Energy manager at the time. That was the first time that I heard how much plutonium was stored at the plant, the first time I had an inkling of how much radioactive and toxic contamination was going on, and the first time I began to understand how dangerous that plant was and how it's right in my own backyard. It was that night I'll never forget. My heart just sank. I had grown up in a neighborhood where there was cancer in every household. We thought that that's the way it was. At that moment, I knew that I would quit my job, and the day that I quit my job was the day that I knew I would write a book about my experiences. And what I did know was that it would take 10 years of research and writing to pull this book together, very heavily researched, very heavily fact-checked. And what I wanted to do with this book is really do what Chris Van Hollen was talking about and other people have mentioned here today, and that is to paint a picture. I wanted to put a human face on what is ultimately a very inhumane story. And you know, when I first wrote this book and when I first started researching it, people said, particularly in Colorado, they said, you know, Rocky Flats is a secret. It's a very controversial story, best to, and I quote, many people said this to me, let sleeping dogs lie. Let's just pretend it didn't happen. Let's just go on, not talk about it. Over the course of several years, we've had what I'm sure some of you know is a very compromised cleanup at the site. The site is not clean. It is not safe, and yet we are building houses right next to it. Including an elementary school. The ground was just broken 2 weeks ago for a new elementary school adjacent to the contaminated site. So the legacy continues. One of the things that has happened since my book came out and it's been out now for about 3 years. And as I said, many people felt that it would never be published. My six-week book tour has turned into about 3.5 years at this point. I've traveled all over the world talking about Rocky Flats, and it's been a tremendous opportunity for me. One of the most interesting things to me is that people in London, in Edinburgh, in Mexico City, in other places around the world know more about Rocky Flats than we know in this country, and particularly in Colorado. People in my own hometown don't know as much as people in other cities where I've spoken about Rocky Flats. It still is a big secret. And yet the legacy remains. And Rocky Flats is important in so many ways. It's important environmentally. It is important historically. We were essentially the heart of the Cold War effort. We produced the heart of essentially every nuclear weapon in this country. And it's very important that we recognize the historical aspect of Rocky Flats and we tell the story truthfully, which that alone is a controversial topic. What part of the story are we going to tell? How much of the story are we going to tell? And there is an ongoing public health issue to the present day. One thing that happened when my book first came out is that I began receiving emails, and I knew many of these stories already. But, you know, I had grown up with them. Many of my friends had cancer. Many of the kids I went to high school with had cancer. There were a lot of deaths and that sort of thing. And yet, nothing was that, like, we weren't supposed to talk about it. And people said, well, you cannot prove a direct link. It's just, you know, just the way it is. The joke in my family was that Rocky Flats is why we all have such glowing personalities. You know, we just... It was just, but, you know, more people started writing to me, and I got letters, and I got emails, and all of these stories of people who were sick, and people who had animals that were sick. Dogs, there's a new dog park right out next to the site at one of the new subdivisions they're building out there. There are dogs getting cancer in the paws because their paws are on the, you know, on the ground, and the soil. Horses with strontium in the bones, all these stories. And so every time I spoke, I would say, we need another study. We need studies. We need studies. We need studies that are independent from some of the organizations and groups that have economic interests in developing that land into houses, businesses, shopping malls, all that kind of thing. So as of last May, we have a new health study coordinated by Metro State University, and Colorado State University and other universities are chipping in. And I brought some copies for you, which I'm happy to pass around if you're interested. The study is a very preliminary at this point. It's only been going on since late spring. Last week, we announced the initial results of that study, and I just want to tell you what we're finding so far. Out of nearly 1,800 people, 1,745 people who have completed the health study at this point. We have found 859 cases of cancer, a very high level of thyroid cancer in particular, and a significant number of rare cancers and brain tumors, rare cancers that seem to be tied to radioactive contamination. One of the things that you'll see if you take a look at this handout, I have some of the initial data that this team of researchers had pulled together, and you can see the cluster of cancers. Now, what we thought we would find is circles around the plant related to the location of the primary plutonium production facility and Stanley Lake, as I mentioned, in some of the waterways and things like that. But that's not exactly what we found. We found that. They found that to a certain extent. But what is most striking about this study is that I mentioned the two fires, the two big fires. This is based on Department of Energy information. There's a plume that extends over the Metro Denver area. My house in Arvada is kind of right at the heart of that plume. Both of those fires follow that plume. And what we're finding is that as you zero in on this information, the incidence of cancer, and rare cancers in particular, and thyroid cancer, follows the pattern of this plume. And when we released this information last week, it's almost strike, it's so specific, you can almost plot it street by street. It's stunning. So it's too early to say exactly, you know, what we're going to find. The study is ongoing. I'm very grateful that this is happening. And I think we can anticipate this being a very significant study in terms of potentially showing a direct link between radioactive and toxic contamination, in particular plutonium, americium, and tritium, but plutonium in particular, and also carbon tetrachloride. And I think we're going to be able to see a pretty direct link. And so as a researcher and as a journalist, that makes me very happy. And as a person who grew up in Arvada, Colorado, who has lost many friends and classmates and coworkers to cancer, it's a very important story to me. So I don't want to take up too much time. I want to make sure that we have time for questions also. But I want to end by just reading you just a little bit. I'm so grateful to be here today, and I'm grateful to all the hard work that people are doing in this area. And one of the things that I did with this book is I tried to tell the story of Rocky Flats from as many different perspectives as possible. The workers, the residents, the scientists, some of the activists, the great Dr. Carl Johnson, director of Jefferson County Health Department, who was fired from his job for opposing home construction near Rocky Flats because of the plutonium contamination in the soil. He later won a whistleblower lawsuit. All sorts of different people. I wanted to tell the whole story. But what I want to do is end by just reading you a very brief section about a particular day at Rocky Flats. And I don't know, perhaps some of you were there when this happened. This happened on April 28th, 1978. And this is just a very short section. Some of the people here I'll just mention include Mark Robertson, my boyfriend in the first, I was 17, 18. He was the first one to say to me, you know, they're doing things out at Rocky Flats that we need to really pay attention to. There's some of the other people in the scene include Daniel Ellsberg, who helped coordinate this protest. And my sister, Karma. Karma is a Norwegian name, not a hippie name, even though we grew up right next to Boulder. And then one of the security guards is Debbie Clark, who was one of my high school friends, and she was a security guard out at Rocky Flats. On the morning of Saturday, April 28th, 1978, as many as 6,000 people gather at the west gate of Rocky Flats to demand that the plant be moved or shut down. The spring sun is bright and the day starts out warm. The crowd is peaceful, the press is there. After the speeches and music, clusters of wild doves are released to the sky as a symbol of peace. Somewhere in the crowd stands Mark Robertson. My sister Karma is also there with her friends. One of the security guards is Debbie Clark. As the day goes on, the wind picks up and the temperature drops. Rocky Flats is known for extreme weather, especially in the spring, and it begins to rain. As the protesters walk to their cars to pack up their belongings and head home, the rain grows cold and turns to snow. A group of about 120 protesters, including Daniel Ellsberg, stays behind. They take their signs and sleeping bags and pitch camp on a rail spur on the south side of the plant where the railroad tracks cross Route 72. In front of the camp, they post an American flag and the solar energy flag. Ironically, the Department of Energy's Solar Energy Research Institute is just down the road. As darkness falls, they pull together their sleeping bags and sing the familiar Vietnam-era slogan, "Hell no, we won't go," with a slight twist, "Hell no, we won't glow." As the night wears on, the weather turns fierce with high gusts of wind, sleet, and snow. The protesters put up a makeshift shelter of plastic sheeting over the tracks, but it's almost impossible to stay warm and dry. When the sky finally begins to lighten and turn pink over the dark blue mountains, Daniel Ellsberg emerges from his sleeping bag to discover two wild doves perched on a tent frame and 65 soaked, freezing people, more than half of the original group, still huddled on the tracks. After coffee on camp stoves, the group discusses strategy. Ellsberg and many others want to continue the occupation on the tracks. Jimmy Carter is scheduled to speak at the Solar Energy Research Institute. In his inaugural address, Carter spelled out his hope for a world without nuclear weapons. With the world's press focused on the protesters and on Carter's visit, it seems a perfect opportunity to increase public awareness of Rocky Flats. The activists believe they are effectively obstructing the flow of radioactive material in and out of the plant. Some want to stay. Others disagree. The protest has already been successful, they note, and they don't want to jeopardize the positive effects of Saturday's nonviolent action and the careful negotiations that helped achieve it. But Ellsberg's group stands its ground. They decide to create a new name to distinguish themselves from the groups associated with Rocky Flats, and they call themselves the Rocky Flats Truth Force. The word gets out. Even people from other states and countries send food and supplies and letters of support. Rockwell's first response is to appear unconcerned. They announce that they don't use that particular spur of track anyway. Making note of the ongoing blizzard conditions, one Rockwell official says, "All I can say is I hope they don't catch cold." On Friday, May 5th, however, their patience runs out. Rockwell and the Jefferson County Sheriff's Department order the Truth Force to leave. The activists refuse. When the first train approaches, they sit down on the frozen railroad tracks. The train slowly chugs to a stop, and officers step forward to make arrests. As the group is led to waiting school buses that will take them to Golden for legal processing and then on to the Jefferson County Jail, Daniel Ellsberg flashes a victory sign to reporters. Marion Daub is with that group. At 17, she's the youngest member of the Rocky Flats Truth Force and a senior at Boulder High. She calls her parents that night after her arrest to tell them she intends to go back out again. Her mother is upset. She wants her daughter back in school the next day, studying for final exams. One arrest is plenty for one school term, she says. Ellsberg sees Marion on the phone in tears, and he pulls her aside. He says he has a daughter, just a little older, and he understands how her parents feel. Protect your relationship with your parents, he says. It's important to maintain their trust. Marion decides to go home. 2 days later, the Rocky Flats Truth Force is back on the tracks. Wearing down jackets and wool caps, the members trek through snow carrying a huge American flag. They set up a new campsite and pack walls of snow to shelter it from the wind. People on cross-country skis and snowshoes bring supplies, but it's not long before security officers in black riot gear show up to warn them of their impending arrest. The train comes again, a brown diesel locomotive pulling several cars, including a white car with a familiar sign that indicates radioactive cargo and the words fissile material, radioactive. Once again, the protesters sit in the path of the oncoming train, some lying across the tracks with their heads on one rail, feet on the other. The train continues to chug toward them. For a moment, it seems like a crazy game of chicken. Finally, the train slows and stops. There is silence. Suddenly, the doors slide open and two rows of officers in black helmets emerge from each side of the caboose, moving as if in silent, slow motion through the deep snow. The protesters offer no resistance, letting their bodies go limp and sing, "We shall not be moved." The officers lift the bodies from the rails and carry them to the waiting bus. This time, 23 people are arrested. "We'll be back," Ellsberg tells the press. "We're effective here, as the arrest shows. If they keep us in jail, it doesn't matter because there are so many more ready to take our places." The booking process lasts into the evening. Later that night, Ellsberg finds himself in a room with two women who have just been arrested. One is 17-year-old Marion Daub. Ellsberg is surprised to see her. She tells him she spent the day in classes at Boulder High as promised, but saw the arrest of the Truth Force on the evening news. She saw that no one was sitting on the tracks. "So the two of us," she says, nodding to her companion, "went out there." The camp was deserted. Carrying flashlights in the dark, the two women held hands and began walking in the snow down the tracks toward the plant, singing, "We shall overcome." When they saw the train coming toward them, they sat down in the snow between the rails. The train chugged to a stop, and a solitary security officer emerged and tried to pull them off the tracks. They went limp. He called for backup, and they were arrested. "The two of you stopped the train again?" Ellsberg asks. "Alone?" Marion nods. "Who is your friend?" Ellsberg asks. "My mother," Marion answers. Thank you.
Thank you. Kristen, that was wonderful. I'm going to buy your book again.
For full disclosure, this is a bit of an interlocking directorate and conspiracy. These two speakers to my left, Linda, I mentioned, is with Beyond Nuclear. I happen to sit on the board of directors of Beyond Nuclear because it's one of my additional passions. And John Tierney is the executive director of the Council for a Livable World, which you may know was founded by Leo Szilard, the physicist who warned with Albert Einstein about the possibilities of the bomb, and so we began the Manhattan Project. But Leo, being brilliant and obstreperous, realized that he had made a mistake. He began to petition not to drop the bomb. He kept at it and helped with other atomic scientists to oppose the bombs. But he ultimately, as he was sitting at the DuPont Plaza Hotel, still there, I don't know what they call it now, senators would come and go to see Leo Szilard sitting in the lobby. He was that effective, that famous, that brilliant. And he finally decided, you know, in 1962, the year that Rachel Carson had Silent Spring come out, he says, I have educated, I have lobbied. But he probably said, I have educated, I have lobbied. We have to unelect the bastards. And he formed the council as the first political action committee to unelect those people that we have tried to educate, we've tried to move, and that we need more Chris Van Hollens. And so I also happen to be on the board of the Council for a Livable World, of which John is the executive director. So there's the conspiracy, and I'm sure we will find many other connections amongst ourselves as the day goes on. So let us hear from Linda.
Thank you, Bob. I'm not an author. I would love to be an author. I wish I could find the time, but I am one of the founders of Beyond Nuclear, an NGO here in the Washington, D.C. area. Our primary focus is on ridding the world of nuclear power, but obviously there's an integral connection to nuclear weapons, which I'm sure you're all familiar with. I wanted to start just by sort of paraphrasing another wonderful woman author, since we're in many ways celebrating many women authors today, and that's Elizabeth Barrett Browning. Nuclear power, how do I hate thee? Let me count the ways. So I did count the ways, and I found 18, and then I realized I had 10 minutes or so, 15 minutes, to gloss over these 18 things that I came up with. And normally if someone said, could you please summarize all the things that are wrong with nuclear power in 10 minutes, I would give you the sort of bug eye like look, but since Bob asked, of course, I immediately said yes. It's a pleasure to follow Kristen, who I met actually at Los Alamos, interesting place to make an acquaintance, read her fantastic book. Please read it. It is absolutely what we've been talking about today, a personalized version of what is often an arcane and technical story. This isn't at all. It's a page-turner, actually. You won't be able to put it down, so I encourage you to read it. I was very struck by the passage you chose, Kristen, because everything that popped into my mind as you read that passage was about the Dakota Access Pipeline and how we are still in those same struggles, how we still have to go back to the rail lines and the truck routes and the construction sites and say no. And that's something we have to do with nuclear power as well. Just to sort of sum up the situation globally, nuclear power is on the decline. It's financially extravagant, especially if it goes very badly wrong, like it did in Japan. The industry is declining, and renewable energy, meanwhile, is skyrocketing. And so it is fundamentally game over for nuclear power, but it's going to take a while, and of course, with the waste and the eventually shut down nuclear power plants, it doesn't just magically vanish. We did just get some good news this week. Vietnam just decided to abandon plans, thank goodness, to build nuclear power plants on its tsunami-ridden coastline. And South Africa, where I just was, I wish I could take credit for this, but I can't. As we marched through the streets of Johannesburg last week and flew back earlier this week, decided to postpone its nuclear power plants quite significantly into the future. So we are seeing progress, but we have a long way to go. Bob mentioned earlier that that climate change comes up, you know, nuclear power comes up in the context of climate change as well. You know, we need it for climate change, which is a wonderful myth. There are a couple of very compelling reasons why nuclear is completely useless for climate change, one of which is time. It takes a very long time for a nuclear power plant from beginning to end to get built and come online. We don't have that kind of time with climate change, as we well know, when we feel the warm temperatures today and when we look at what's happening around the globe. And as even a conservative outfit like MIT noted, you would have to build a new nuclear power plant about once every week and a half for 30 years to make even a sort of slight dent in carbon emissions, and that simply isn't going to happen. One of the reasons it isn't going to happen is the incredible cost of building these things. And most of the time you hear only the construction cost estimates, which are already about $12 billion per unit. That's probably highly conservative. Some estimates have them as high as $19 billion. But if you look in my homeland of the UK, where they're trying to build a two-unit plant at Hinkley, the lifetime costs are estimated there at $48 billion, and yet the UK government is going ahead with this. And who will pay for it? Well, the ratepayers will pay with a fixed price in their rates that is three times what everybody is paying right now. Because no nuclear power company will build a nuclear power plant unless we pay for it. And that's what's happening in this country with the plants that are under construction in Georgia and South Carolina. They've been paid for in advance in the rates, and they will be paid for in federal taxpayer subsidies. So it's an economic proposition that has no appeal to any company that isn't willing to gouge you and I. Another obvious reason is that they are just incredibly dangerous, and the consequences of something going wrong at a nuclear power plant dwarfs pretty much any other industry, especially the electricity industry. And we've seen that clearly in the last several decades with Chernobyl and Fukushima. But even on a daily basis, there are many things that can go wrong in a nuclear power plant that are not addressed. The ones we have in this country now are getting old, and as some of us know in this room, when you get old, things start to go wrong and more things break down and you have more aches and pains. We can go to the doctor, a nuclear power plant cannot. It should be overseen by our federal safety regulator, known as the U.S. Nuclear Regulatory Commission, or as our colleague at Union of Concerned Scientists says, it stands for No One Really Cares, and what we say is no regulatory control. Because unfortunately, the Nuclear Regulatory Commission is in the lap of the industry and invariably bows to any kind of economic pressure that it hears from the industry to let them not fix that or not install this. And so our reactors are in a dangerous condition. A couple of examples of this. The Nuclear Regulatory Commission's previous incarnation knew in 1972 that the GE design, which is the same design that blew up and melted down in Fukushima, Japan, knew in 1972 that these were deeply flawed designs, and even GE's own engineers recommended that they not be built. We still have 30 of these operating in the US, any one of which could suffer the exact same disaster as Japan. It doesn't take a tsunami or an earthquake, although we could have an earthquake. It takes a loss of power, which can happen a number of different ways, often through human error. Sometimes we've had a situation where a raccoon has climbed up a power line and got itself electrocuted and shorted out the electricity of the nuclear power plant. When the Northeast blacked out many years ago, that was a tree limb falling in Ohio. That's what we're, you know, we've depended on luck for a very, very long time, and that's something that will run out. You may have heard of the new reactor that just came online in Watts Bar, Tennessee, the Watts Bar 2. It's an ice condenser reactor, which was recognized by our so-called safety regulator as 100 times more vulnerable to early containment failure than other types of pressurized water reactor. Guess what happened? They licensed it anyway. It was allowed to be built. It took 43 years between start to finish, it just opened now, and the industry actually had the chutzpah to tout this as a new 21st century reactor, whereas in reality, it's a 1960s design that is deeply flawed and was recognized at that by our own safety regulator. Another reason nuclear power is bad is, of course, the waste issue. And I don't think I need to go into any great length because that's the one that most people know the best. There is no solution to disposing, managing, taking care of this waste at the moment. Nobody in the world has an open geological repository to put this waste in. We may never solve it, and yet we keep on making it. That is the most insane piece of this story. You know, I have kids, and if I never said to my kid, tidy your room, you can imagine what condition that room would be in after even just a few days. And we've had 70 years of the nuclear industry not tidying its room, but making more mess. And we're now stuck with a lot of waste, with no place to go, and a few very bad ideas. The unscientific, geologically unsound Yucca Mountain, which Obama canceled, and the person I refer to as he who shall not be named will probably reopen it. We've got a plan to move it out of the reactor sites where it's all stored right now to various sites across the country in so-called interim parking lot sites, a very bad idea because of the risks of transportation as well as sitting somewhere that's unsecured. So nobody has solved that. You might hear people, unfortunately, like Bill Gates and others saying, well, you know, we can build the better nuclear mousetrap. There are new designs. We'll invent new reactors that will eat their own waste and won't melt down. And the designs they're talking about are all old designs, sodium-cooled reactors, small modular reactors that have been around for decades and have been rejected over and over for various reasons. Sodium-cooled reactors have a tendency to catch fire, not a good thing when you're talking about nuclear power plants. Small modular reactors, just from an economy of scale, don't make any sense. You know, why would you build lots of small reactors when you can build one big reactor that is going to give you a much greater economy of scale? So they aren't, and also lots of small reactors take a very long time to address climate change. So it's really kind of a non-starter, and that's why there are no buyers for small modular reactors at all anywhere right now. And there really isn't any meaningful new build happening. Yes, in China, but China does everything. And they're doing a lot more on renewables than they're doing on nuclear. Way more investment in renewables. So they're kind of an all of above scenario. But everywhere else, I mentioned Watts Bar, you know, that one took 43 years to come on. Most reactors around the world, they're under construction. There are some famous ones, the French, which was supposed to be the sort of flagship of the nuclear scene, has their European pressurized reactor under construction in Finland and France. Years behind schedule, billions over budget. They may never finish them. Lawsuits abounding, especially in Finland. So this is not an answer to climate change. It is a way to set up a sitting duck terrorist target or another Fukushima waiting to happen. And then you'll hear about the propaganda. What's fascinating to me is that it used to be we need to build new reactors for climate change. But now, because the new reactor thing is really a non-starter, it's we need to keep the old reactors going for climate change. But then in comes he shall not be named, where climate change is a hoax. And now the nuclear industry is saying, oh, no, we don't need nuclear for climate change. We need nuclear for jobs and for infrastructure. You'll notice infrastructure is a favorite buzzword, right, in the incoming administration. So they just ride whatever horse seems to be winning at the time, but it has no foundation in reality at all. Then you'll hear things like, well, they're all reliable, but they're unfortunately not very reliable. First of all, the future of the energy system is about being flexible, bringing electricity on and off quickly as needed. That's something that large baseload suppliers cannot do. They're either on all the time or they're off. And that's why renewables are gaining traction, and that's the future of the grid, distributed and flexible generation. And of course, nuclear power, when it goes off, is unavailable, and it has to go off for refueling. It has to go off for repairs, and of course, if it melts down, it's pretty much permanently off. So not so reliable. In fact, in France, when there were droughts and heat waves, they had to power down their reactors because they need water to cool the plant, and import coal from Germany. And in fact, because, despite rumor, the French nuclear power sector has hundreds of incidents every year with their reactors, they're down a lot for so-called repairs, including right now. So right now, France is importing coal to support its electric heat supply. You may do the English thing and cough at me if I'm going on too long, and then I'll skip to the end, as they say in The Princess Bride. So speaking of water, why would we, facing climate crisis, why would we choose an industry to generate electricity that consumes lots and lots of water? Some nuclear power plants draw in 1 million gallons of water a minute. 1 million gallons of water a minute. This is madness. Water is going to be, we already know, the bone of contention, the shortage, the probably the provoker of wars. So we do not need to escalate nuclear power around the world using up precious water supplies when they are going to be needed for human consumption. But we're here because of Rachel Carson and putting that sort of human story on these sometimes rather dry technical issues. And the human story for the nuclear power industry really crosses the entire fuel chain, but it's the beginning of the fuel chain that is the least talked about and the most overlooked. Because when you hear all the propaganda about nuclear power, it's only about the generation of electricity. Nobody talks about where the fuel comes from. In fact, we don't even talk about it in its own name. I really don't like saying nuclear power. I think it should be called uranium power. We talk about oil, coal, gas, solar. We talk about the fuel for every single other electricity provider except nuclear, which sort of is nice, kind of anesthetizes the whole thing, sanitizes the word. It sounds kind of like medical, scientific, cool. If we called it uranium power, people would know when they switched their light on where that power came from, and it comes from uranium mines, which are mostly worked by indigenous peoples around the world, including in the U.S. Very little uranium mining is still going on in the U.S. It's in Wyoming, and I think it's Nebraska or Nevada, but Nebraska and Wyoming, the two places still. About 8 to 10% of the uranium that goes into U.S. nuclear power plants comes from there. The rest is imported. So it's not even, you know, so-called energy independent type of electricity provider. And where that comes from are places like Kazakhstan, Russia, Australia, Canada, and so Niger. Often, as I said, the risk, the harm, the health impacts, and none of the so-called profits or benefits are taken by these uranium miners, who end up with all the diseases and none of the benefits. And of course, uranium mining also consumes water and leaves a huge amount of detritus behind. About 80% of it's just tailings, they call it, you know, waste rocks that are left on site, and a small percentage actually goes into making fuel for nuclear power plants. So it's very inefficient. And health is a big issue throughout the fuel chain. A lot of people don't know that nuclear power plants routinely release radioactive liquids and gases. And in fact, in Europe, they've done several dozen studies around nuclear power plants where they have found that there's a 37% across the board, 37% increase in leukemia amongst children living close to nuclear power plants. And the closer they live, the higher the rates are. Now, this is something that's kept very much under wraps, is not talked about, is challenged endlessly. But it means that in this country, most people who live around nuclear power plants, which children, have no idea the risks they face. And in fact, there was supposed to be a cancer study that the National Academy of Sciences was supposed to conduct at the behest of the Nuclear Regulatory Commission. Phase one was completed. It was starting to look, you know, like bad news. And so the Nuclear Regulatory Commission canceled that study. They claimed that it was a financial issue, but they have a great big building in Rockville that they don't even use. That, how much money did it cost, Paul? I can't even remember. Millions, you know, $30-40 million sitting there empty. So it's not about money. It's about what they were going to find. And they were going to find similar stories to the ones that have come out in Europe. And of course, then you have catastrophic releases. Again, I urge you, If you're interested in the issue, watch any film in which there is first-hand accounts of living in the aftermath of the Fukushima nuclear disaster. These are compelling human stories. It brings it home what it really means to lose your home, to split your family, to watch your cows die in the field of starvation because you can't go back and help them, on and on and on. The impact of a disaster is so huge that you could, in fact, render an entire swath of land the size of Pennsylvania uninhabitable for the foreseeable future. Think about the 9/11 Commission. If you look at that, you see that the attackers had eyeballed the Indian Point nuclear power plant 30 miles from downtown Manhattan as a target. If they'd taken that out, Manhattan would be uninhabitable for the foreseeable future. Imagine even trying to evacuate Manhattan, which is another problem, which is there's really nowhere to run to. If you look at evacuation plans, they're insane. They can't possibly work. A lot of these plants, there's just a single road out. Some of the sirens are hooked to the grid. If the reason the nuclear plant has gone down is the grid's gone down, the sirens won't go off. You're told as a parent that you must not run to the school and get your child, you know, you must evacuate in an orderly way and they will be evacuated. Can you imagine as a parent if there's a nuclear meltdown going on, not running to the school and getting your child? So all these things are completely impractical. And I do want to just touch on animals because Rachel Carson obviously, you know, got her inspiration from animals. And one of the studies that's been done around Fukushima and also Chernobyl by Dr. Tim Musso, I urge you to look at, has studied the effects of animals in the aftermath of these disasters. And what he found should be a sort of sentinel warning to all of us. And Bob mentioned Helen Caldicott, although she isn't a founder of ours, we did inherit her 501c3, and I love to sort of channel a moment of Helen to say to you gentlemen in the room that one of the findings that Musso found amongst birds was low to zero sperm count. Low to zero sperm count. Cataracts. He found that the debris, the forest debris was not decomposing. There were so many things in his studies that should be warnings to us all that this is what's happening to the animal life. It's probably going to happen to us too. So we don't need to go the root of nuclear power. You'll also hear sort of the jobs, you know, the jobs thing. I'm sure we're going to hear that in the coming couple of years. But again, it's a myth. The nuclear power industry does employ people, sometimes temporarily, to build nuclear power plants. But the renewable energy world is the big winner for jobs. You can just look at the example of Germany, where there are 30,000 people approximately employed in the nuclear sector, 300,000 and growing employed in the renewable energy sector. It revitalizes the entire chain of industries. So even just because you're building a wind farm offshore in northern Germany doesn't just enrich that community, it enriches a whole supply chain of industries all over the country and provides jobs. And even here, the US solar industry is adding jobs 20 times faster than the rest of the economy. American wind power supported a record 88,000 jobs at the start of 2016, an increase of 20%. We've got to hold onto that because this is going to be under assault in the coming administration. This is where the jobs really are. This is what's going to help the people who, for whatever reason, voted for him, thinking it would help them with employment. So that's the battleground that we've got to fight. And it's not an either or. You know, you cancel nuclear and you're getting fossil fuels. We've seen that already in California where they shut down nuclear power. They're turning to renewables, not even to natural gas. In Nebraska, same story. So that's where the money is, that's where the jobs are, and that's where the future is. Just to wrap up, a couple of last things. Intermittency. You still hear this, well, the sun doesn't shine all the time and the wind doesn't blow all the time. And I would direct you to Joe Rome of Think Progress, and I urge you to read him because he's very good on this subject. And one of the things he said was, the intermittency problem is essentially solved. The willpower problem, however, isn't. And that about sums it up. The World Bank Morgan Brazilian, who told Bloomberg after 20 years of studying intermittency, quote, very high levels of variable renewable energy can be accommodated both technically and at low cost. There's better predictability, and the more renewables you bring on, the more predictable it becomes. There's demand response. You know, we can power down our use at certain peak times. That helps renewables. Electric vehicles are coming on. People are looking at, you know, how can we use the battery storage of electric vehicles while they're not being driven around? there are lots of ways, you know, battery storage is coming on, the price is coming down, the price of renewables are coming down. The intermittency thing is, you know, fingernails on the window ledge argument that's being clung to, but is basically been solved. Renewables are already the preferred route. At the Paris meeting a year ago, there were 11 countries that said they would consider using existing renewables for climate mitigation, but 144 countries who said they would use renewables. There were 6 countries who said they would consider new nuclear power for climate change, and 111 said they would expand renewables for climate change. So as the World Nuclear Industry Status Report, another very good resource, stated, nuclear is a niche carbon abatement strategy, while use of renewables is universal. So between 2013 and 2015, global investment in renewable energy was nearly 5 times as much in solar as nuclear and 4 times as much as wind than nuclear. New electricity in the US in 2016, renewables outpaced natural gas by a factor of 70 to 1. So that's where the action is. It's not about a technical problem. It's not about logic. It's about politics. That's where we've got to fight for renewables. So I'll just close by reflecting on another wonderful sort of author. You remember that song, Sisters Are Doing It For Themselves? I always liked that song. So renewables are doing it for themselves too. That's the way forward. Thanks so much.
Thank you, Bob. Yeah, I also don't have such meaty topics and such knowledge and depth that my 2 previous colleagues had. Bob gave me the topic of discussing the possible Trump nuclear policy going forward. As they say in the vernacular, I got nothing. I got nothing. I don't think any of us do, but it does bring to mind a comment that Martin Fleck, who Bob knows, on the Physician for Social Responsibility, had out there. He has a little saying whenever he sends out an email at the bottom. It says, you know, if we keep going in the direction in which we're going, eventually we're going to get there. And that's an old Chinese proverb. And apparently we intend to keep going there, nuclear. We keep going along the same direction, and except for groups like the Rachel Carson group or individuals who write books and organizations that start up, you know, there's very little pushback on the political scene. One of the reasons Leo Szilard finally determined that, you know, we have to try and do something politically to change this dynamic. Because we have the research, we have the facts, the information and the knowledge, we have to bring it to those that are making the decisions, whether they're in an administration, whether they're in a Congress, or whether they're just in some influential outside group that needs to have the materials and the information to go forward and make the case on that. And so we have to do that, and that's what we've been doing over at the Council for a Livable World. And to put it in a more positive frame than Bob put it, Bob was talking about Leo Szilard unelecting those people that don't get it, and that's part of what we do. But we also look to elect people who do get it. We spend a lot of time going out. We raised $1.4 million for candidates this year who got it, had a good idea of a progressive national security vein and what should be our policy on nuclear weapons and nuclear materials on that. And we unfortunately had about a 50% success rate in this tidal wave of he who I have to name, Trump, on that. But the interesting thing is, you want to talk about what Donald Trump's philosophy is. There's been a lot of chatter about that around. This is not my first set of comments on that. It's all speculation. So I'm not going to stand here and tell you that here's what Donald's policy is going to be, and it's going to lay out in the following manner on that. We don't know. He had contradictory statements during his campaign, and since his election, he's had contradictory statements with what he said during the campaign. And he's putting people in office who would raise your hackles in any event to figure out what the hell are they going to do. They are people that are off the wall for the most part, who come and hit, you know, who just look like they've come unhinged. And you look at a Rudy Giuliani, who he thinks he might want to appoint the Secretary of State, and you say, my God, you want that trouncing around the world as a representative of the United States? He looks like his feet are hardly touching the ground, you know, and he's just all discombobulated out there. So it's a frightening proposition. The question is, who is Donald Trump going to listen to? Can we be the last ones to speak to him, or nearly the last ones to speak to him? Because I think that has a great influence on where he's going. He spent an hour or so with President Obama, and all of a sudden he wasn't as upset with the Affordable Care Act as he had been before. You know, he talked to people on global warming, and he wasn't as concerned with global warming as he was before. And we have to make sure that we're talking about nuclear weapons and nuclear materials, that we get people in front of him so that he won't be as right about going out and starting to use them, because you have them. What do you have them for if you're not going to use them, was his comment. You know, we have to back that down and turn it around and convince him in some respect that it's a legacy issue for him to be the one that marches in the other direction. He could be the next Reagan and going to Gorbachev. He could be the next one that takes an issue right off the bat and changes it around to his legacy on that, because we are heading in the wrong direction. We're going to get there if we're not careful. You're looking now at the modernization aspect be a very important issue for him to deal with. It's great to use the word modernization, and it's unfortunate in this case it's used by both Democrats and Republicans, too many of each who stand behind this notion of building more nuclear weapons for deterrence on that. But the idea of modernization sounds great. Who wants an old, insecure, unsafe thing out there rattling around? But we cannot let them use it as a ruse for our proliferation, which is what too many of these countries, including the United States, are doing. It's not a question of going out and saying, well, we've determined right now that we need a deterrent, and we ought to fight to get to a level, the lowest level possible, and then keep negotiating down and eliminate these weapons. We need to say that, you know, this is a situation where you look, even if you want to keep it in that context, what exactly do you need, and what has to be done to keep them safe? What you don't have to do is build faster missiles, more powerful bombs, and more of them, and station them all around the world where they're insecure, and fail to get fissile materials secured and put it safely and then eliminated on that. So we're moving in the wrong direction. We are going to get there, I'm afraid, at some point in time. We've been lucky. It's interesting. People since the Cold War, in many instances, probably not the people in this room because you're very active in a range of issues, people seem to think that there's no longer a nuclear crisis out there. Cold War's over. Who'd be crazy enough to use it? On that basis. Let me share with you another woman writer who's had a much acclaimed book this year, Rosa Brooks. And here's how she posited it. We literally have no points of comparison for understanding the scale and scope of the risks faced by humanity today. Compared to the long, slow sweep of history, the events of the last century have taken place in the blink of an eye. This should give us pause when we're tempted to conclude that today's trends are likely to continue. No nuclear annihilation so far? Thank God. But what on earth would make you assume we've solved that problem rather than just had a run of mostly unmerited good luck? We have had a run of unmerited good luck. When you go down, read Eric Schloss's book, Command and Control, and read about all of the accidents that have happened. So after the Cold War, people may think that there's no leader of a nation out there that would go out and purposely use a weapon, although our friend in North Korea certainly would give us pause for that. The conflicts between Pakistan and India would make us concerned about that. The fact of the matter is you don't have to have somebody decide they're going to push a switch and make it go. You can have an accident. You can have a miscalculation. We have many of these weapons on high alert. All it takes is somebody to think that somebody else has taken an action, and the way we have our system set up right now is about 30 minutes. 30 minutes for a president, soon to be Donald Trump, to have to decide whether or not to push back. So he's going to be in a mood to tweet, or is he going to be in a mood to push the button? You know, and those are the serious things on that and why we have to be concerned and why we have to really start to do something about that. You can run down the issues that he has to talk about. Modernization. It would be great if we could convince him, you know, that this is a movement that he could go and try to say to everybody, let's have some sense. We don't need long-range missiles now, stealth missiles. We have enough of those already. We have ones that are conventional, don't need to be nuclear. They can take care of the same problems. We don't need to build more and more powerful bombs. We don't need to have all of this new stuff coming on in the guise of modernization, but we can, until we continue our negotiations to get rid of nuclear weapons on that, make sure that what we have is safe. We could eliminate the whole ICBM system, right? We have the triad, as you know, the ICBMs on land-based, a couple hundred of those out there, several hundred of those. You have the naval submarines, and you have the bombers. There's no reason in the world why you need a triad, except that the Army needed something, the Navy needed something, and the Air Force needed something, which is not the way it ended up, but it's the way it originally began. Everybody needed their piece of the pie. It was also the idea that, you know, you had to have this great response of ICBMs in case somebody was going to launch something, they would think twice. But now, because you have the submarines and you have the bombers, you don't really need the ICBMs. In fact, they're destabilizing because they're the ones that are on high alert. They're the ones that are going to go off, and you can't call them back. You can call back a submarine. You can call back a bomber. but you cannot call back those missiles that go out of those silos once they're on their way. And that puts everybody at serious, serious risk on that basis. So the other issue you talk about, what else could he do that would make sense? You know, he could go to Russia right now, which he claims is a friendly country. He claims that Putin is somebody that he can deal with. Now, I think that a lot of us on the council, on the board, I don't want to speak for Bob and others, I think we're somewhere to the left of Hillary Clinton and to the right of Donald Trump, if you can believe that. Right? So we're not as naive as Donald Trump to think that Putin is somebody you can trust and you want to go out and become fast friends with him. And we're not as hardcore as Hillary Clinton, who I think is even more conservative on this than President Obama, that you don't ever want to speak to the guy or anybody over there and shut them down, have no conversation, they don't deserve it, keep those sanctions. Somewhere in the middle there is a way that we have to do what we did in the 1980s and convince Donald Trump that he could be that person to do it, to understand all that is wrong with Putin and with Russia, but to say on this issue, on the nuclear issues, we have to have a way of conversation. We have to have a way of sitting down and talk about that. It's what happened between Reagan and Gorbachev. It had happened because people in the grassroots levels, Helen Caldicott and others get into this issue, Carl Sagan, and just had an uprising. All right, had it in Russia, had it in Europe, had it in the United States, of people understanding just how serious this issue was and forcing it upon their elected officials to take action. The groundswell that came up about, we don't want to be the ones on the short end of something being lobbed by mistake or accident or miscalculation, and you all had better do something about it on that basis. And that's what we have to get back into doing on that. We have to be worried about North Korea. But again, you know, this is an idea with Donald Trump. If you are such a man who can cut a deal, now is the day. Right, we're probably not going to get much further than we are right now in any result with North Korea just by saying we've got sanctions, we're going to put tougher sanctions on you, and we're going to rely on China to make sure those sanctions are enforced, and eventually you can be brought to your knees and you'll get rid of your nuclear program. As a good negotiator he's supposed to be, Donald Trump will realize that's not going to work because China does not find it in its interest to shut down North Korea. They'll end up with millions of North Koreans banging in their back door and coming in and destabilizing their country. They'd also end up with a peninsula over there run pretty much by Japan, South Korea, and the United States. Not a circumstance they want. So at some point, there is a need for a great deal maker, a great negotiator, to understand the sanctions have a role, and they have to be done in a very intelligent way on an international scale, but it has no role at all unless you can also supplement it with negotiations and a conversation, which means you have to address what are the concerns of the North Korea, as well as what are the concerns of the other folks over in that peninsula in the United States and Europe. And that, and if we don't do that, you know, we're going to have some serious issues on that. So here's an opportunity for him to stand behind and show us what a deal maker he is and what a negotiator he is on that basis. But doing more of the same is just going to mean we're going to get where we're going, not a pretty circumstance or a pretty sight on that. The test ban treaty has been waiting around and waiting around. All of us in the community have been sort of reluctant to bring it in there because we're afraid it'll get defeated again. And the last time it got defeated in the U.S. Senate, it's been a long time even getting it back on the agenda or getting it back to people's attention. But this is something, if he's such a good negotiator, let him get on the stick and say, let's have a comprehensive test ban treaty. Let the United States pass it in the Senate. It would be a great example for the others who have not yet had it passed and signed on in their nations and move forward on that basis. So there's opportunity after opportunity for him if he listens to the people who can put it out in a way that makes him motivated to show what he can do for his legacy, as opposed to just firing off tweets or reacting or getting angry or listening to some of the cockamamie theories that some of his advisors put out there. So that's, you know, the base of it. We have all of these issues. All of them are ready for somebody to deal with. I don't know where he's going to go. We all don't know where he's going to go, but we know where he should go, and we know where he has to go. So what can we do about it? Well, we can try to get elected people that have the right attitude and the right policy on that, and we'll continue to do that. We'll continue to support them in their elections and then inform them and educate them and give them the analysis they need going forward to do their jobs. But we can also partner with all of the people in the other areas that are interested in what's going to happen with the Donald Trump administration, whether it's social issues, whether it's Black Lives Matter, whether it's the environment, global warming, all of those issues. And don't let them keep us in our silos. Because if they can keep us in our silos, we are all more fractured groups. We're more worried about our organization surviving, about whether it's going to get the funding from grantors and individual contributors, about whether our agenda issue is number one and getting the attention that it needs, as opposed to letting us all become one big family and rallying to each other's cause. And so when he's got an issue coming up on global warming, that's going to be the issue, why wouldn't you look to the nonproliferation crowd to say, okay, It's coming up. It's a hot issue right now. We will join with you. We'll talk to our membership about it. We'll rally them behind what you are doing. We'll work with you to get the information that needs to be out there. And consequently, when there come issues, whether it's modernization or anything in nonproliferation, we would like to be able to turn to you and say, look, it's coming up next week. There's going to be a vote. Tremendous amounts of money are going to be allocated, or there's a bill specifically related to it. We need to get the temperature up. Will you join through with us, shoulder to shoulder? Let us use your list. Tell your folks what's going on. Share the analysis education that we have on that so that people involved with the environment also become knowledgeable about nonproliferation. People with nonproliferation interests also become involved with global climate change and energy and things of that nature and do this. We cannot let them keep fracturing us into a million different non-for-profit groups out there with well-intentioned, well-meaning people and members out there focus so much on just their issue that we never get large enough, we never become excited enough to get out there and force a response. So we're trying to look into that at the Council for a Livable World. We're meeting regularly with people, particularly in the environmental, because everybody has a concern in the environment on that. And you've got a lot of different groups working on it. Those groups have to come together, but we'd like to come together with them and become part of that voice and ask for their help as well. So that's one thing that we can all do, and hopefully we'll move in that direction, and hopefully we'll have a Donald Trump that we don't recognize yet, you know, and that's a scary thing to do. It is, I don't have a lot of good things to say, but if we get a Donald Trump that we fear, then we've just got extra work to do. We did it in the 80s, and we can do it again. We can't be defeated, and we can't be afraid to get younger people involved with us. I think on these issues, unfortunately, a lot of times it's the older folks that have more energy than the younger folks. They're distracted. They have a lot of things going on in their lives and everything like that, but so did we. So did we. And we manned the barricades, and we went out and did those protests on that, like the young 17-year-old woman that you were talking about or whatever, and she got her mother involved. I think we got to turn that around. We've got to get our younger generation involved and get them out the barricades as well. Thank you.
We have time for a few questions, and then I think I'm going to have a short break. You have all been wonderfully stationary, and so we'll find out if our panel mics work. I'll simply call on people, or you can just start shouting. Hi.
Come on, you can say what you really thought. You know, no, I don't disagree with you on that. My fear is that he doesn't, but in that case, we appeal to the shorter term, his ego. All right, your ego. You're such a damn big shot, and you can cut a deal. Cut a deal now. You know, why don't you cut a deal now? And maybe you're right. Maybe the phrase is not the legacy issue on that, but that oversized narcissistic ego of his. You know, it's like, if you think you're so good and you think you're such friends with Russia, then why can't you cut a deal on the most important issue? And I don't mean to denigrate it. Look, there are three existential threats, right? We have global climate change, we have pandemics, and we have the nuclear issue. So the global climate change is coming on with time over decades and periods of time. Pandemics take a time to build. Nuclear issue is 30 minutes. 30 minutes. And it's done. Life as we know it is over on that basis. So if this is an important issue for him, he's got such a big ego, he's so damn good, then why don't you get out and cut a deal with Russia right now? Because all the other issues, whether it's Pakistan and India or North Korea or anything like that, it really all comes back to Russia and the United States. All right? We have over 90% of all the nuclear weapons in the world. All right? So we also have the leading ability to do something about fissile materials that are unprotected and insecure. All right? So go and deal with Putin and pick that issue and get to his ego on that, and that's probably the better way to do it. You're right.
trying to pass the bucket. You know, but no, look, they, in my estimation, that treaty was probably the finest diplomatic action that's been taken in decades by this country. And it was enormously complex and difficult. If we didn't have Muniz at the table with John Kerry, I'm not sure what would have got done. He played an incredible role in that because he brought the technical expertise and the ability that we needed to be able to rely on some of the mechanisms we put in for monitoring and verification on that. I think that it's going to be extremely difficult for Donald Trump to back off of this in any large way. I fear more the incremental small things that he might not do that he's supposed to do under the agreement and try to force, he will try to force Iran to be the ones that back out of it on that basis. As you know, his appointees are dead set against it. I mean, they are just Iran-phobic, and that's an issue on how hard they're going to be pounding on him. But we've been working very hard in the nonproliferation community to try and get the Europeans and the Russians and the Chinese to make very clear that they have no intention of backing out of this thing. They've cut the deal. There's good businesses in it for all the people in Europe in particular. There's security in there for Russia and China. They understand that this has actually accomplished what it's set out to do. And they've been speaking out. Even Saudi Arabia has spoken out and made clear that, you know, they've done resolved an issue for at least 15 years, and they have no intention of bringing that back into the fold or whatever. So as upset as they were with Israel, they want to move in that direction. And the Europeans have come out and made it very clear that they have no intention of backing out.
There, ah, there. Aha, okay. yeah, I don't believe we imported waste. The plutonium came from Hanford, and then the bombs and the weapons themselves were put together at the Pantex facility. So most of what was stored and continues to remain at Rocky Flats was produced at Rocky Flats.
But you said there was strontium. Strontium is a fission product, and that should have been removed at Hanford.
Absolutely. So and that's a very, very interesting issue and question. And one of the things that has the Department of Energy has said for years is that there was never a criticality at Rocky Flats. However, certain contaminants in the environment seem to indicate that there was at least one criticality at Rocky Flats, one in 1957 and again one in 1969. So that may explain some of the things that we're seeing in the environment. There's so much more testing that needs to be done. I'm not an expert in criticalities, but based on the people that I've interviewed and the research that I've done, many people do indeed believe that there were possibly two criticalities there.
Well, thorium you hear about thorium reactors, but it's actually thorium-fueled reactors, and you still end up with nuclear waste. It's, you know, I direct you to our website. We have actually a long fact sheet on thorium, so rather get into the sort of long technical explanation. I suggest you read that, but that pretty much debunks the idea that thorium is some sort of new panacea. It has plenty of its own problems associated with it, and it doesn't get rid of the waste problem. Asking about the export of nuclear power. Exporting of nuclear weapons.
You know, our GA, we're always talking about our budget and our economy, and we have been guilty of being a seller of weapons.
Well, we sell plenty of weapons, but other than what might be classified and we don't know about on that, on the nuclear thing, I'm not aware of any nuclear weapons that we're selling to anybody. We are locating nuclear weapons in different parts of the NATO team. On that, you had 60 nuclear bombs, over in Incirlik in Turkey. We made those. We situated them. Now, the odd part is, of course, there's no delivery aspect in Turkey, so the bombs just sitting there, not very well guided or protected at the time, although they've increased security since the uprising in Turkey on that. But there are 60 sitting there for no other reason than to try and make Turkey feel comfortable with the fact that they're in NATO and that they're part of the team and that we would trust them to have those things there. But there's no intention of using them. There's no delivery system there.
How do you feel about
this? I feel very opposed to it, and we are very opposed to it on that and try to put pressure on that whole aspect. The idea of having those kinds of weapons situated around in different countries on that is not necessary any longer on that, even for deterrence on that basis. And now, because of George Bush pulling out of the anti-missile defense treaty, Russia has again taken it upon itself to start getting more tactical weapons into its mix or whatever. So not intercontinental ballistic missiles so much as tactical war field types of things that they want to use. And Pakistan is doing that as well. So this is not a good direction in which to move. This is not a healthy way to do it. And this is part of what has to be negotiated down and out on that. But we should all be alarmed at that. You can stop it. I'm not sure Donald Trump is the one who's going to do it, but we should and we could. My primary ask would be to start with a sharing of names, lists, and information on that. I mean, I would love to be able to bring our issue to your members, and I would be more than happy to have your issues brought to my members. So if you thought that you had a model that could be replicated around different parts of the country, we have members all over the United States. So if you thought it was a model, we'd be happy to share that information on our email list and recommend that people go to your website and consider starting a model on that basis. And I would love the opportunity to have brought to the attention of your people, here's another issue that I'm almost 100% sure you would care about. If you care about the things that you're dealing with, you're going to care about this issue as well, and just be able to try and get them sensitized and knowledgeable on that. That'd be a great place to start.
I think it's a very, I mean, I agree with you entirely, and we've tried to do this a couple of times, actually, and it's a phenomenally hard challenge, and there's something about the culture of Washington, D.C., I hate to say, which is in the way of that, this siloed idea, the protecting the funding. We get, so, well, we don't want to take that on because then it's a whole new learning curve, and we don't really know nuclear power, so in order to sort of endorse your position, you know, we would require expertise. We're not going to just take it on faith and so forth. So I think that, I mean, recently, for example, we tried to put together, you know, a sort of joint statement just on our position on nuclear within the Green Movement. It was incredibly difficult to get everybody on board. We didn't, actually. So that's one of the challenges, that we're very good at that on the progressive end of things, arguing, you know, and splitting hairs and holding ground, right? And so it makes it really hard.
Just to say that on the environmental end, when I was part of what is called the Green Group, 34 to 36 major environmental organizations, we ultimately combined our list, and it was an incentive led by Ted Turner and other billionaires who wanted to see this happen because they were tired of seeing 34 different little groups send you all different stuff. It was very, very difficult. Then the climate change challenge actually led major environmental groups that did not have it in their mission. They did parks, they did bunnies, they did wildlife. But through help and encouragement from funders and from outsiders, we were pulled together and said, this is a huge crisis, we've got to pull this together. Now we face perhaps an even bigger crisis of pulling all our groups together it will prove difficult. I wanted to go to one last question.
Can I just say one thing, Bob?
I want to add something really quick. Go ahead.
Bob already knows this, so I'll vent a little bit more. I'm new to the not-for-profit world, all right? I had business for 20 years, then I was in Congress for almost 20 years. Then I got to the cockamamie, non-for-profit world where there's such, I think, over-reliance on a model that's not going to be sustainable for very long, and that is going hat in hand to foundations or grant-giving organizations and begging them for money on a year-to-year basis. I mean, so you spend half your year doing a report telling them why it is you got the money that you were using, and the other half of the year filing an application asking them for money to do going forward, and them never wanting to share with you what it is they really want. So it's like you come to us with a program, we'll tell you we like it or not, instead of them saying, here's what we'll fund, so come to us some ideas in that ballpark, and it would be easier to do. So I think a lot of it goes back to the foundations, and maybe at some point we all get together and say to them, look, if you really want to do somebody some good, then as Bob said, when it happened to the groups he's talking about, it happened because they said, okay, here's some money, go do it. Right now, everybody's money's tapped out. They're all working in deficits or damn close to it on that, and they need some bigger thinking foundation or group of foundations to say, all right, here's some resources. Here's what we want you to do. Everybody will get some action of this, and they'll get a project to do within the bigger project and the resources to do it, so they're not looking cross-eyed at each other and wondering who's going to get credit, whether or not they're going to get the funding for it.
Yeah, and I just want to add something kind of more on a grassroots level. For one thing, one thing that's happened in Colorado is now spreading is that we have a number of organizations. One is called Candelas Glows, the development, housing development that I talked about where they're building on contaminated land is called Candelas. A group of citizens has started, they're called Candelas Glows. They have partnered with another organization locally called Rocky Flats Downwinders. So I brought some information about those. And those organizations are reaching out to others around the country, and it's turning into a pretty big kind of grassroots kind of thing. So it'd be great if we could get, sort of rope all that in. And then the other thing I want to mention is that Full Body Burden has been chosen as a common read book for more than 25 universities around the country. And so what that means is that an entire university and then often the city also reads the book. And I am so encouraged by talking to people who are 18, 19 years old, and I've spoken at many of the major engineering programs around the country where a lot of these kids are on Department of Energy scholarships and that sort of thing. And what they are interested in, their heart's in the right place. They are interested in ethics and the environment and public health. And it's just been tremendous for me, and it's also helped me develop a network of people at universities as well as these grassroots organizations. So I agree completely with what you all are saying, and somehow we need to bring this all together.